Penguin Random House Audio presents Shark Drunk, The Art of Catching a Large Shark from a Tiny Rubber Dinghy in a Big Ocean by Morten Stroksnes. Translated from the Norwegian by Tina Nunnally. Read for you by PJ Ochlan. Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea or walked in the recesses of the deep? Job, chapter 38, verse 16. Summer. Chapter 1. 3.5 billion years. That's the time it took from the moment the first primitive life forms developed in the sea until Hugo Asjord phoned me one Saturday night in July. "Have you seen the weather report for next week?" he asked. We'd been waiting a long time for a very specific forecast. Not sunshine or heat, not even the absence of rain. What we needed was the least possible wind in the seas between Boda and Lofoten, or to be more precise, in Vestfjorden, the western fjord. If you need calm waters in Vestfjorden, you better not be in a rush. Its tumultuous waters are notoriously temperamental. Even the slightest gust of wind from the west, south, or north can create significant waves. I'd checked the weather reports for weeks. The forecast was always for strong or gale-force winds. Never just a gentle breeze or light air, which would give us the calm seas we needed. Eventually, I'd pretty much given up keeping track and surrendered to Oslo's lazy summertime rhythm of hot days and bright nights. I was at a lively dinner party when my phone rang. When I saw the call was from Hugo, a man who hates phones and only rings to deliver important messages, I knew that our long wait had come to an end. We were finally going to try to catch the big fish. "I'll buy a plane ticket tomorrow and arrive in Boda Monday afternoon," I told him. "Good. See you." Click. On the plane to Boda, I fixed my gaze on the land below. Through the oval window, I could see mountains, forests, and plains, which I imagined as a raised seabed. A couple of billion years ago, the entire Earth was covered with water, except maybe for a few small islands here and there. Even today, the ocean still makes up more than 70% of the Earth's surface. It has been said that our planet's name shouldn't be Earth. Instead, it would be more appropriate to call it Ocean. When we reached Helgeland, the land opened into Norway's majestic fjords, with swelling seas to the west, until finally the division between sky and water dissolved, and the horizon became a shining gray color reminiscent of bird feathers. Every time I leave Oslo and travel north, I have the same sense of escape. Escape from the inland and its anthills, spruce trees, rivers, freshwater lakes, and gurgling marshes. Goodbye and farewell. I'm going out to the sea, which is free and endless, rhythmic and swaying like the old sea shanties sung across the oceans of the world on ships traveling to classic harbors like Marseille, Liverpool, Singapore, and Montevideo, while the deckhands hauled on the lines to set, trim, or reef the sails. Sailors who have gone ashore can seem like restless visitors. They may never go to sea again, but judging by their talk and gestures, it's as if they're merely temporary visitors on dry land. They never lose their longing for the water. Yet the sea, which is calling them, has to settle for hopeful, if uncertain, replies. My great-great-grandfather must have felt the sea's mysterious pull when he left inland Sweden and began walking west. Through valleys and over mountains, he traveled like a salmon along the great rivers, first against the stream, then with the stream, until he made it all the way to the sea. As the story goes, he gave no reason for the journey other than that he had to see the ocean with his own eyes. It's unlikely he had any plans to go back to where he'd come from. Maybe he couldn't stand the thought of spending the rest of his life stooping over barren patches of land in a Swedish mountain village. Clearly, he was an impulsive man, a dreamer, with strong legs. He wandered all the way to the Norwegian coast, started a family, and then joined the crew of a freighter. A couple of years later, as fate would have it, the ship sank somewhere in the Pacific. Everyone on board drowned. As if the man had come from the depths of the sea and needed to return. As if that was where he belonged, and he'd always known it. At least, that's how I think of him. It was the sea that gave birth to the poetry of Arthur Rimbaud. The sea inspired his expansive language, which carried both him and poetry into the modern era with Le Bateau Ivre, The Drunken Boat, from 1871. The poem is told from the perspective of an old freighter that wants to experience the freedom of the sea and hurtles recklessly down a great river until it reaches the coast and enters open waters, only to encounter a violent storm and sink to the bottom. There it becomes one with the ocean. And from then on, I bathed in the poem of the sea, infused with stars and lactescent, devouring the azure verses, where, like a pale, elated piece of flotsam, a pensive, drowned figure sometimes sinks. From the airplane, I tried to reconstruct more of the drunken boat from memory. I know the swells attack the skerries like frenzied herds of cattle, and on the ocean floor, a leviathan rots among swaying clumps of kelp, which reel the drunken boat in close, wrapping it in their tentacles. Above the dark abyss of the maelstrom, the boat hears the mating calls of the sperm whale. It sees dead drunk shipwrecks swarming with sea lice and hideous snakes, golden singing fish, electric crescent moons, and black seahorses. Things that people only imagine they've seen. The boat is pummeled by the sights, experiencing the frightening and liberating power of the sea, the constant surge and spray, until it becomes languidly, numbingly sated. Then the boat begins to yearn for the dark and quiet river pools of its childhood. Rimbaud had never seen the ocean when he wrote this poem at the age of 16. Chapter 2. Hugo Asjord lives on the island of Engeloya in the municipality of Steigen. To get there from Boda, you have to take the northbound catamaran ferry, traveling between islands and small, weather-beaten communities that cling like barnacles to the rocky coast. After about 2 hours, the ferry docks at Bogøy, a small village with a bridge that crosses over to Engeloya. Engeloya is like a microcosm of Norway. Typical Norwegian fjord country on the side facing the mainland. Archipelago and white shores on the seaward side. The belt of land farthest south and by the sea consists of fertile farmland. Beyond that is a forested strip where moose and other wildlife live. Finally, valleys and mountains, of which Trohornet, 2,116 feet above sea level, is the tallest. There are good reasons why people have lived here for nearly 6,000 years. This island, which you can easily bike around in a couple of hours, gave them ample opportunities for fishing, hunting, and farming. Hugo is standing on the wharf and has good news for me. Apparently, we have bait. A Scottish Highland bull was butchered a few days ago, and the remains are out in a field, ready for me to pick up. That can wait until tomorrow, Hugo says as we drive across the bridge to Engeloya and pull up in front of his house, complete with a tower on top, a gallery in the basement, and an unimpeded view to the west, toward Vestfjorden. The square tower, designed by Hugo, could have served as a stage set for Henrik Ibsen's play, The Master Builder. Arriving at Hugo's property, it's easy to imagine that you've entered a pirate's lair. Scattered around the garage are objects that have been plundered from the coast. Lining the path to the gallery, the prow of an old ship and several huge old anchors stand like exhibition pieces or trophies. In the backyard is a propeller that once belonged to an English trawler that went down off the island of Skrova. On the shed hangs a Russian sign.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.